Welcome to a very special edition of Icons featuring our most requested guest of all time. He is an actor, musician, writer. He is the voice of Lucario, the voice of Firefly, the voice of Hawkman, and he has been the definitive voice of Goku in the English-speaking world for 20 years. Please welcome, starring in an interview so big that it has to be two parts. This is part one of two. Please welcome Sean Schemmel. I can't believe you're here, man.
Well, it's only too big, not because it's a big interview, but just because I talk a lot. So, but it's nice to meet you, Geekdom. Do you go by Geekdom or 101 or Mr. 101? Can I call you Mr. Geekdom or Mr. G, or what should I call you?
I'll take Mr. G, but you don't really Mr. G. Call me that. You can call me
Danny.
I
might refer to you as Geekdom or Mr. Dumb. Well, that sounds offensive. I shouldn't call you Mr. Dumb. I should call you Mr. Dumb 101. No, I'm kidding. I just only know you as Geekdom. Plus, I'm terrible with names. So that's what I'm going to call you, if that's okay.
Well, I'm sure enough people online call me Mr. Dumb, but.
That's not nice. And we're going to get to that meanness online at some point.
Yeah.
What world we live in. Well, I'm happy to be here. And, you know, honestly, I don't do a lot of interviews. I want to be real frank. I don't do a lot of interviews for a couple of reasons. In my experience, I'll talk a little bit about Dragon Ball here, but because we're going to do that, I think, in the next interview. But we're going to focus on, you know, the personal stuff here for this part of the interview. But I don't do a lot of interviews because my experience since I got on the part on Dragon Ball, since I got the part of Goku, is that everybody on the internet wants to use whatever popularity I have to make their show more popular, and then they benefit, and it doesn't benefit me at all. And
yes,
a lot of actors don't realize this because they want all the attention they want, because some actors are narcissistic actors and they want all the attention they want. But I'm not, because I didn't grow up as an actor. I didn't start as an actor. I have more attention than I want and more Twitter followers than I want. Now, don't get me wrong. It doesn't mean I don't love my fans. It is the coolest thing to have all these people, you know, texting you. I mean, I don't ever get upset in terms of, like, you know, another fan's bugging me, but I do, because I treat fans, and I don't even like using that word, like human beings. I feel like I need to address, which is why I don't address. So there's a certain sense of feeling used a lot, and also I don't do a lot of interviews because, frankly, a lot of interviewees on podcasts, they're just not very good journalists or not very experienced, and so they don't ask me very good questions, or they won't ask me questions that, you know, haven't been asked me 1,000 times that can be found on the internet. So there's really, you know, I know it sounds selfish, but I'm like, you know, after 20 years of doing it and helping so many other people with their podcasts, at some point you got to go, okay, what's in it for me? Because I don't want any more attention.
Right.
And it's not that I don't like it. I feel a tremendous, I have 90,000 Twitter followers, which I know isn't a ton in the grand scheme of celebrity. But to me, it feels like 90,000 people I have to answer to every day. And I think it's actually disingenuous when a celebrity or a talent plays the nice card all the time and isn't real with their fans. So, you know, which, you know, is why maybe I'm a little bit controversial when it comes to my responses and how I interact, because I feel like if I placate someone and just give you the safe, nice political answer, I'm insulting your intelligence. And if you come at me aggressively, or if you come at me with a direct question or an obnoxious question, and I don't respond like I would if I was just a dude on the street, I'm being disrespectful, even though it may seem disrespectful if I do that. That's basically my philosophy. But anyway, and the reason I did the interview with you is because I had you on a panel at Kamehakan, and you did a great job. And most guys who moderate our panels don't. And so I was pretty impressed with what you're doing there, and your commitment and passion to Dragon Ball in general, and the fact that you had the idea to interview the other half of my life, which is everything un-Dragon Ball related generally, which is what we're talking about today. So thank you for having me. That's my big long intro.
No, thank you for doing it, because, you know, this, you're actually, I'm the only, this is the only interview that I know of from somebody in my genre, or in my, I guess you can call it line of work, that has interviewed you. And it means a lot to me. It really does. And and one of the reasons why I wanted to get you on is because I know, look, man, I know you get tired of answering the same questions over and over again, because I see it. And that's why I was so passionate about Kamehakan, because I wanted to ask you and your peers questions that weren't always asked every time.
No, that's great.
Yeah, but I also feel like a lot of people don't understand who you are. I feel
they
like
they don't.
Yeah, and in talking
I
to
don't.
You. I mean, look, we've only talked like four times, for an extended period of time.
Couple of months, yeah.
Yeah, but
we talk a long time, and we did cover a lot of subjects. I was doing that for two reasons: to get to know you and what your approach is, and also kind of let you know about me, and to see if we jibe as a because sometimes I get with an interviewer and they can't jibe with me, and I can't jibe with them. And I enjoyed our conversation. So I was like, okay, well, I think I can work with this guy on an interview, you know, and plus it gives me an opportunity to kind of, clear up some things, most of which will be cleared up in part two, but I definitely want people to, you know, I on the one hand, I think it's a little bit weird and narcissistic to say, I want you to get to know me. But at the same time, it's very frustrating when, you know, I make a comment here, or something's taken out of context or whatever, and the people don't really know where I'm coming from. They don't know what I've been through. They don't know what struggles and trials and tribulations I was facing during the whole, before I got on Dragon Ball, and during the whole production process of the show, and all the politics and all the drama regarding that show. And one thing I want to point out here to everybody listening is that this is what's really important to know when we talk about anything, whether I'm talking about another actor or myself or a company like Funimation. You know, I don't think, with the exception of a few companies I've worked for and that I have worked at, Funimation's not one of them and Toei's not one of them, but most companies I worked for, everybody is trying their hardest, the best they can, with the best talents and the best intelligence they have, and mistakes get made. And that being said, you know, this is a free-form interview where, you know, I'm hesitant to do it because so much of what I say gets taken out of context. And there are people who are genuine shit starters who I find extremely annoying and should probably shut up. But they want to do that, and it makes my life and job miserable. But I try to just, you know, rise above it and not deal, because I have to suspend my philosophy of you know, giving every interaction basic human respect. And I've made mistakes in the past and tweeted things I regret, and that's why I've deleted them, you know. And that's what irritates me. If I tweet something and I screw up and I say the wrong thing and I delete it, that's because I don't want it to follow me around for 20 years. Yet some jerk has to copy it and then repaste it or re
put it on
to
the
show
board.
Me that I said it. Look, we're organic beings who are growing and changing all the time. I was a much bigger jerk and asshole when I was 18 than I am now, and I'll probably be a lot nicer, hopefully, by the time I'm 70, you know. So we're all growing and evolving people, which is why I'm hesitant to attack people online, because I've done that before, and it makes me just as much of a jerk if I do that. So that's one of the reasons I want to do the interview, is just to really get clear on some things that I could point a reference to, so should someone want to do that. But
well,
at the end of the day, I'm thrilled to be talking to you, because look, I work on the greatest show on TV, and I've been doing it for 20 years, and a lot of actors can't say that, so I'm pretty happy about that.
No, and I'm glad you said that, because I'll tell you this, you know, and speaking to you for the last few times that we've talked, one of the things about you that I think people really have to understand, and for better or for worse, is that you're an extremely passionate person. Like, you're you're not one of those people who just comes to work to collect the paycheck and goes home. You know, there's that joke in The Simpsons where Krusty the Clown comes in and he does the voiceover, and he's there in like 2 seconds and leaves before the audio engineer can even get everything ready. You are not Krusty the Clown, you know.
I'm the opposite. I screw up in sessions. I'll pick on the engineer, or I'll pick on the mic pre, or I'll pick on the fact. One time I was in a session, I could tell the tubes needed to be changed in the Avalon 737 SP. And I could hear it. I'm like, we're going to change the tubes on? Like, I am a picky ass, and I agonize over every line. And so it shocks me when I get shit for something, when I'm like, do you think I'm not thinking about this 24/7? And just because you're a fan and spend all your time thinking about Dragon Ball, that, you know, you somehow think that you know better. And not that I know all the facts about Dragon Ball, or that I know all the lore, or I know, and a lot of those things don't really have a bearing on my performance. But as far as the emotional state of the character and the spirit of the character, and in particular with Goku, but I'm this way with even, you know, a show that's not popular, that has not, you know, I'm working on a new pilot and it's not famous, and I'm just like, and I have to really put my passenger hat on, because I've been an ADR director, I've been an engineer, I've been a writer, I'm familiar with the how to do the jobs of most people I'm working with. That doesn't necessarily mean I do them better, of course, and I have my own strong opinions, and also my talent style is I like to butt heads a little bit, because, and not in a bad way, but I like to, because I've discovered that if a lot of times you don't get the diamonds you really want unless you squish the carbon together really hard. And so a lot of times I want to challenge somebody to make them shoot me down, so that we know we have the right answer, even though, you know what I'm saying? That's kind of a weird, and we'll talk more about that in part two.
Yeah.
I'm very, very passionate. I'm very committed to it. And that comes from the level of dedication and commitment I had to make to classical music, which is kind of what this kind of segues into my history and personal life.
Yes.
You know, that passion and commitment I was a very, very aggressive and very hardcore, serious classical musician. And for those of you who understand this, who are classical musicians, you know that in that, you know, when you start out, especially if you're a young violinist, and I know a lot of violinists and a lot of, you know, when you have those instruments you can play when you're 6 years old, French horn's not one of them. But when you're basically marrying your instrument for your whole life. In fact, when I sold my first French horn, it felt like I was getting divorced. You become one with the instrument. It is a discipline and a craft that is, you know, goes back centuries. And it is one of those things that once you start doing it in a serious way and you want to be a pro, your life is that. So when I got the part of Goku,
it was your new attitude. Instrument.
It was a new instrument for me, yeah. And it was the best. And I liked it more than horn playing. And I'm a very passionate. My horn, French horn training was, and my attitude toward it was very similar to the movie Whiplash. That resonated for me a lot. And I went to North Texas State University, which people don't realize this, that it's UNT now, but it has one of the finest music programs in the nation, probably second or third only to Juilliard or Eastman. And in some cases, at least the horn department at the time, one of the best French horn studios in the nation. And so I went to a very, very disciplined, I went to the College of Music, which is kind of a, it's not a, what's the word I'm looking for? Not a collegium, a conservatory. It's similar to a conservatory in the way it's structured and the way the music program is structured there. So there's a lot of hardcore disciplinary, and I'm not the most disciplined guy. I'm actually pretty lazy, but when it comes to doing something, it's like I'm lazy, but when it comes time to focus, it's like total laser. And so I go back and forth between that, where some guys are, you know, consistently a laser and sometimes are consistently lazy. I tend to vacillate. But when I'm doing my art or doing my craft, it's 110% balls to the wall all the time, no exceptions. I don't care. So that might bleed into my passion regarding, you know, the character, et cetera, and how I feel about it. And I understand, and just so we're clear, I don't want to, you know, there's going to be some bitching about people who are passionate, et cetera. And there may be some things I say that may seem like I'm not appreciative of the passionate fans who give me shit. For those of you who do give me shit, I'm actually super grateful that you even care that much to give me shit. Right. Meaning you care so much about the show. It means a lot to you. That's freaking awesome. And it's the greatest thing in the world. And I never begrudge anybody their opinions. The problem is if you think your opinion's going to change the way I do anything, the answer is zero. And that's not because, and even if you're right, the answer is still zero. Because I didn't get into this business to have somebody else puppet my work. I listen to the director. I listen to, and I even fight with the director. Chris has directed me for years, and we'll debate, you know, on stuff. But when I first started, I couldn't fight with anybody because I didn't know anything. And so when you play the character as long as I have, you get a certain amount of professional carte blanche. And my goal has always been to try to divulge from the perspective as much, or divine, so to speak, as much information I could on the character from various sources, such as Akira Toriyama, when I can find it, in the context of the difficult parameters I was put into taking over the role, which was from the Canadian cast, which we're going to get into in part two.
Yes.
But going back to classical music, a big part of how I approach voice acting comes from music and comes from being a musician. And when I was a director, ADR director in New York, we discovered that our best dubbers weren't necessarily regular actors. I mean, there are some irregular actors out there who are, and by regular actors, I mean, don't typically do cartoons or voiceover. They're more on stage or on camera. A lot of them had trouble because they weren't used to being confined by mouth flaps. They weren't used to expressing themselves largely in a booth with just their voice. And so we found that it was musicians and instrumentalists, musical theater people, and singers tended to do better at dubbing, anime in particular. At least me and my friend Michael Center Nicholas noticed this. I worked for his studio, NYIV Post, for 3 years and studied with him. And he trained me on a lot of things. And then we collaborated on a few projects. And then I went our separate ways because I couldn't handle the production schedule on top of all the voice acting I was doing. And I miss it. And it was a great, great experience. And he's probably one of the finest ADR dub directors out there. I don't think he gets enough credit for what he does. And there's a lot of schlock out there that sucks that people think is good, in my opinion. Of course, who am I to talk? I don't know. That's what's weird is you start talking about what sucks and what's good. You get into one man's, you know, junk is another man's treasure. So And that brings me to another subject, the subject of subjectivity. There's a bunch of stuff I did in Z that I think sucks. and that's because I was young and fresh. And there's a lot of it I think is great. And there's a lot of it that people think sucks that I think is great. And a lot of it that they think is great that I think sucks. The point is that I shouldn't define for any fan how much or what they should like, you know?
Plus,
I mean,
all their opinions are different anyways.
Exactly. And that's what's great about opinions. Everybody can have one and, you know, nothing's, you know, the law. But anyway, getting back to, but we're going to get in that. I'm afraid we're going to, you know, tangentialize into part two. And I really was appreciative of the fact that you wanted to focus on my background.
Yes. So, I wanted to ask you, because I do want to talk about your musical background as well, because that passion you had for the instrument carried over. And I've noticed that with a lot of artists and creatives is that, you know, people, I don't know if you were like this, but I assume you were. You were probably one of those guys that would stay up till 2, 3, 4 in the morning just working on your craft. Were you one of those guys?
Well, I'm not disciplined like that, but what I am is I'm almost, and people have joked with me, and I say this in all kindness, so I don't want to offend anybody, but people have joked with me that they thought when I was younger that I might have Asperger's, and I do have some traits that, and I have a cousin with autism, and it does run in my family, but I don't think I do, but I might, but I it wasn't so much like I was working on my craft till 2, 4, 3 more in the morning as much as it was like an autistic person might obsess on something and do something over and over and over. I would do it like that all the time. So, for example, I was a kid and I was fascinated with voices and I was fascinated with how voices sounded, and I was fascinated with sound in general. And I particularly did not like, you know, I was born in 1968, so black and white television was still pretty popular, and black and white TV shows were still in reruns. You know, you'd see I Love Lucy, and you'd see a lot of 50s shows in reruns in the 60s and 70s. And so there was a lot of old shows and I didn't like because they were in black and white television, and I wanted to color television. So I would turn the volume down on the TV, and I would make up voices and dub a show using different characters in real time for hours. So I would just be making shit up, and I would go to one character, then the other character interrupts that character, and then I would do a voice for that character, then I would watch other shows, then I would try to do impersonations, then I would do impersonations of everybody I meet, then I would do it, you know, constantly, all the time. As a matter of fact, we had a house guest recently with one of Bree, my girlfriend's friends, and I know I'm going, you know, I'm taking a shower or whatever, and they can hear me doing whatever, and they're like, does he do that all the time? I'm like, yeah, I'm always playing with voices. I will frequently, if someone has a very unique voice, I will try to mimic it immediately, and I offend people a lot, and I'm not trying to. And when I was younger, before I was even a voice actor, I remember walking into a Chili's once in Texas, and the hostess was like, hi, how are you? Welcome to Chili's. And I went, I'm fine, how are you? Like, right immediately, like, totally mocked her. And I wasn't trying to mock her, though. She just had this really thick accent, and it just sparkled my brain, and I was like, I gotta do that immediately. I wasn't even thinking about how it might
offend somebody.
It's
like you're
training
yourself, right, in a weird way?
Well, basically, I'm training myself, but I'm not training myself because I'm thinking I need to train myself. I'm just having fun, and I'm training myself. And so, you know, even though I didn't have much acting experience or much voice acting experience when I got on Dragon Ball, I had been practicing voices since about 1972. By the time I had my audition in 1999, I'd done some stand-up comedy, and even my friends in high school and college. Actually, there's a funny story. I can tell you a backstory about the day I don't know how funny I am, but I call it the day I became funny. And that's because my friends kind of call it that way. So in 1985, I moved to Fort Worth, Texas from Odessa, Texas. And I met a guy, was trying to get involved in band because I was heavily involved in the band program. I was already an all-state, first chair all-state French horn player for Texas at that point. And I was, you know, really aggressively focused on that, and I was looking for playing opportunities, and there was an opening for a marching French horn part in the Six Flags marching band, and that was a really good job, by the way. We made a good amount of money with no taxes taken out because we were under 18 living at home, so there was like 18, 20, maybe 25 guys that, you know, we're all friends to this day. And I remember I was pretty introverted. I was a pretty introverted, nerdy French horn player, and I wasn't super talkative. And I was fairly shy until somebody got to know me, and they had written the jazz guys in the group, a guy named Rod Bowens, who's a sax player in Fort Worth. For those of you in Fort Worth, Dallas, you can see him play at any time. He's an amazing sax player, and I think he might be playing with who am I thinking of? There's a band. I'll remember it later because I'd love to plug them because they're a great band, and my friend Willie Roy played with them, who used to play trumpet for Toby Keith, by the way.
Wow.
a great trumpet player. And I went to, I didn't go to high school with him. He graduated a year before me, but I played in the, I played in the 3 o'clock lab band with him when he was lead. We did a thing with Lou Soloff and a jazz thing that needed French horns. I played with that. But anyway, so they'd written this jazz funk song that just had no lyrics, but it was just a melody that we played as we were marching through the park. And I just out of the, and the melody kind of went da 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 da, and out of the blue we were just marching along and we'd kind of died down the melody, and I start going, bought a new dog today, it was blue and gray, and everybody thought that was really funny. Now it's not that funny in retrospect now, but everybody started chuckling, laughing, and I thought, oh my god, they think I'm funny. Hey, I'm gonna try to be funny some more. And so then I tried to be funny some more by doing different impersonations and stuff, and that, and I was successful, and they kept laughing and joking. And so they would do weird. There was a guy named Mark Finley, who's a friend of mine, and we called him Foot Finley because he's like 6'7" and has a size 18 shoe. And he would challenge me. I would get invited to a party with the guys, or we'd be at a party. We'd all be hanging out, and they would say, "Okay, you do a good Grover impression." And I did a Popeye impression. Do an impression of Grover doing a Popeye impression, doing a Kermit the Frog. So they'd ask me to do three impressions at once, and they would constantly challenge me. So I was basically exercising and challenging myself with different characters and getting the head of different characters all the time with these guys. And so much so that there's a guy, another guy who's an old friend of mine named Ken East, who was really funny. He was kind of, he's a lawyer now, but I would show up and he goes, "Hey, Sean, would you please be funny?" He would just say, be funny, Sean. And I got irritated with him one day and I said, "All right," I got with my buddy Travis. I go, "Let's make a tape called Be Funny with Sean Schimmel." And basically it was me doing impersonations of the whole band and singing songs and doing sketches. We knew a guy named Robert Kelly who talked like this. And so we did Robert Kelly reading the phone book and be like, you know, hot pizza, because he had this kind of stilted way of talking. You know, it's not funny to anybody right now, but to my friends, it was extremely funny. And so they would ask me to do this. And they would, and so I made a recording, I made a tape, and then my friend Rod got me into doing some stand-up comedy at a place when I was 18 or 19 years old. And that was terrifying for me because some drug addiction had run in my family, and I was worried that if I were in an environment where there was, you know, drugs and debauchery, that I might fall prey to that as a young man. And so I left comedy and went back to classical music school, which is honestly a much safer environment. Also, my horn professor contacted me and asked me if I wanted to come back to the studio because I quit college for a little bit. And so there's all these dynamics on how I approach sound and how I got involved in sound and voices and stuff like that. So by the time I auditioned for Dragon Ball, honestly, and I can talk about Dragon Ball a little bit here, the Dragon Ball audition for me seemed very easy because I had a lot of public performance experience. I was had been a professional hornist by that point for 10 years. I had performed with different groups. I'd done some theater acting. I'd done. But all the voice stuff was real simple because they were asking us to match the Canadian cast because they wanted to keep vocal consistency. And so to me, it was real simple. I was copying voices, which I was doing all the time.
Yeah.
And I thought I killed the Captain Ginyu audition, but I didn't, apparently. And, you know, and I didn't even think I'd get Goku. I thought I'd probably get Yamcha, maybe Jace and Captain Ginyu. Because my Yamcha audition, I think, was even better than my Goku audition. But Chris really wanted that role because he loves Yamcha. No, I'm kidding. I don't know. He actually got cast exactly what he said. He was on staff, and it was just cheaper to give Chris a bunch of parts than to pay another actor, which is, you know, how Funimation rolled back in the day.
Right.
You know, they don't do that anymore.
Different
but
era.
This isn't, you know, this is, yeah, different era. It's 1999, different staff. I mean, Funimation's practically an entirely new company, with the exception of Gen Fukunaga and maybe a couple others. You know, that day was when I kind of opened up. And so I would frequently get requests to do impersonations. Then I got a job. I was looking for a bee puppet. What's really weird is I always think of life in terms of cause and effect. And I'm not, it's not lost on me particular decisions I made, because I think a lot about quantum physics and I think a lot about parallel time and universes and how we perceive time, and whether or not there's free will, et cetera. But
I want to talk about that with you too.
Well, we're definitely going to talk about that, because I'm pretty sure we're not driving the bus, and it's human ego that gets us in trouble. But and that's coming from a camp of believing that we did have free will, and we were actually self-aware, and I think it's an illusion. But which is funny, because I was watching the end of Westworld the other night, and they posit that question. And I said, I've been thinking about that for 10 years, you guys, and some ancient mystics for like 5,000. So you're a little behind the curve, but still, it was freaking amazing. That show is extraordinary, extraordinarily well done. And it really for me, and just to tangentialize on Westworld, it really kind of, I've always been interested in poking through human ego, et cetera, et cetera. And so when I started watching it, it really encapsulated for me how I perceive humans in reality. I don't perceive us, and I don't perceive humans as some superior species and that we're the ruler. I perceive us as just very, very talented monkeys. And I mean that in a way that's going to offend some people. And I don't mean that in any kind of racial way. What I mean is we are, we'd like to think that we're something, you know, better and beyond animals. But as Westworld likes to philosophically discuss, we're not as awesome as we think we are. And I absolutely believe that. And there's more and more evidence that actually comes from marketing and also the law, which I'll get to in a second, that shows that we're not always driving the bus. And it's an illusion that we are. And Buddhist texts talk about this. And it's really hard to see through because the duality and the ego are very powerful things. And this is why when people take shrooms or they, which shrooms and psilocybin, they, and I've never done shrooms, but I'm curious to do them. And new psychological studies are showing that it attacks your ego center and dispels your sense of ego for the time you're on mushrooms. And then you see the interconnected nature of all things, which you can do through meditation for years. And you can, you don't have to do shrooms to do that. It's just a lot harder process when you're, when you have to meditate for X number of years to achieve that state.
Right.
So
shrooms is a shortcut.
I'm kind of generalizing about that, but what we're back on. So I got a job in the puppet theater, because basically I was looking for a bee puppet. There was a puppet theater called Le Théâtre de Marionnettes, and some of my other cast members have worked there. Kent Williams, Todd Haberkorn worked there after me. I worked there with Kent Williams back in the day in the late 90s. I was going to the mall. I was married at the time, and I went into the puppet theater once, and there was an old woman working there. She wasn't exactly too nice to me. So I maybe kind of want to leave the store, and I was playing with some puppets. She didn't seem like she wanted to help me, so I left. I went to the mall again, and I was literally, I remember this to this day, and this is a definitive moment. This exact moment was when my life changed, and I ended up steering toward Dragon Ball. And that is, wow. I was in that North Park Center in Dallas, and I was about to go down the escalator again. And out of the right corner of my eye, I saw that puppet theater one more time. And I was married at the time. My wife had gone down the escalator, and I was just about to put my foot on the escalator, and I looked up and saw the theater, and I took my foot off the escalator and walked toward the theater, and I called down. I said, hey, I'm going to go back in the theater. Come on up here with me. Let's go back in the theater one more time. I'm going to try to find a bee puppet. So I go in the theater. There's another guy working there, and I'm messing with the puppets and doing some voices and goofing around. And he goes, boy, you seem like you kind of like doing that. You want to maybe work here? And I go, well, what's it about? So and this sounds like a totally creepy setup, and in retrospect, it probably was, but nothing creepy happened. He goes, you want to come in the back and watch a puppet show? So I go in the back with this guy. I'm not going to mention his name because I think he hates me, but I go in the back, and he fires up the opening to Wizard of Oz. They were doing Wizard of Oz at the time. This guy, despite my personal distaste for the guy, is a master puppeteer. The guy is really amazing. And I was into hand puppets at the time, so I was like, I want a hand puppet. But he brings out a marionette, and I didn't really give a shit about marionettes at the time because I liked hand puppets. I grew up on Jim Henson, Muppets, etc. And he brings a marionette out, and it was magical. I mean, he made that marionette look alive, and I was sold. And so what happened was I started apprenticing there, and they made me watch the show every weekend. And I was teaching French horn at the time. I had a studio of about 30 students. I was playing as a freelance hornist with the various orchestras around Dallas-Fort Worth. I would sub here and there. And, I was basically auditioning for symphony jobs, which I never wanted to do. My horn professor steered me towards symphony jobs, and really all I wanted to do was chamber and solo literature, which in retrospect I know I could have done, but he didn't think there was a market for it. My attitude was you create the market, but I didn't have enough verve to fight him on that. So I was trying to get an orchestra job, even though that's not my favorite place to play the horn, although I do like symphonies. But he offered me the job, and I'm working there. There was another guy there who owned the theater who was kind of my mentor, and he died a few years ago in his 80s. A guy named John Hardman, who was a good friend, and he had been the head of the Six Flags puppet shows in the 70s, I think, for the whole nation. I'm not sure if that's true or not, but he had a very strong involvement. He knew a lot of LA people. He knew Sid and Marty Croft and those guys, and he would tell me stories. But anyway, they had me apprentice on this dog puppet, and then eventually they let me use a puppet. And then I have this ability, and I don't know if it's an ability, but this knack of, I would say, you know, like I said earlier, just doing people's voices. And he talk like this. And so I was always doing voices around the puppet theater, doing his voice. And then one day he goes, you do some pretty funny voices. You want to do some voices of one of my new puppet shows? And I thought he meant in real time. But the way we did Marionette Theater is it's a big production. So we record all the voices, sound effects, music, everything on a tape. And then we play that tape and then move the puppets to that tape, even though I might be voicing a puppet. I'm not actually doing it in real time. So, you know, I did three voices for him. I did a Prince voice, you know, for the Prince and Cinderella. And then I did the Mop and the Bucket who came to life. And he said he wanted me to do like a Forrest Gump impression and a C-3PO impression. And then I played my French horn for a couple of the licks. And that was really technically my first voiceover gig, but it wasn't an audition. He just gave me the part. My first audition, professional audition, was Dragon Ball Z. Was in 1999. So all these weird artistic things and my weird attitudes kind of came together to turn me into an actor. But I can say this, once I stepped into the booth at work, it really felt like I had come home and that it was really where I was supposed to be. It really just, it synergized that way for me. So that's kind of a rough idea of how I get it. Oh, my dog's barking in the background. That's Leia. She barks at everything. But
I have questions about Leia coming up, actually.
Oh, yeah. Leia's amazing dog. People want to steal her if they knew. And I'm not just saying that. Because here's the thing. I see people say, oh, my dog's the cutest, and they're not. My baby's the cutest, and they're not. And then people say, well, you're biased because it's your dog. I'm like, no, she is the cutest. Screw you. But I'm probably wrong. It's probably not. It's probably just subjective. Anyway, so what would you go ahead. I'll stop rambling in here and let you talk. Sorry.
No, it's all right. You it's funny because I had a lot of questions. You answered a whole bunch of them in your monologue there.
Well, yeah, I tend to do that because I'm always anticipating it's not really so much I'm anticipating your questions. I'm just thinking, you know, if I'm on any particular subject, I tend to try to include all the details.
No, I appreciate that. I appreciate it. So even before you started, you picked the French horn, you were already doing funny voices. So as a kid, as an adolescent, what was your dream job? Because you, before you went to Texas, you were in Iowa, right?
I was born in Iowa. I was born in Waterloo, Iowa in 1968 on my mother's birthday. I share my birthday with my mother.
Wow.
I was born on her 20th birthday. And the voices I was fascinated with in cartoons, in particular, even Mel Blanc and Bugs Bunny and all the cartoons from the 70s. I lived in Iowa until I was 12, and then I moved to Odessa, Texas. And I, you know, my dad was a minister. Well, when I say my dad, I mean my adoptive father. So I was born without a father, and that kind of affected me profoundly because I remember kind of acquiring sentience one day. And I remember looking up around as a baby, and I distinctly remember, okay, there's a mom, and there's my brother. And then I remember distinctly feeling something was missing because at this point I had interacted with other families, and there was always some older dude present who was called Dad.
Right.
And I did not know that I was supposed to have one of those. So,
wow.
Yeah, it was freaky. And so, and my mom, you know, she was one of the early teen pregnancies. She, you know, I was born on her 20th birthday, but I have an older brother. I think she got pregnant when she was 16 or 17, and she was dealing with teen pregnancy, you know, being the daughter of a factory worker, John Deere factory worker in 1966. And so she was dealing with her own stuff. And my biological father left my mother when she was about 7 months pregnant with me. And then she met my father who adopted me, Franz Schimmel, who is last name I have. I met him when I was about 4 years old. And here's the fascinating fact to me is that he was 19 when I met him. I remember my dad as a teenager. So he was 19. My mom was 26 at the time. And, you know, I really, you know, bonded with him and took to him. And he's very charismatic, very, you know, evangelical Lutheran minister. His father was a minister. You know, I was, you know, and it's a sensitive subject for me because I don't consider myself a Christian anymore. And I was, the Bible was read to me cover to cover from the time I was 4 to 5. And I remember being more fascinated with the artwork and than I was, and how many of the stories seemed like bullshit to me. And I don't mean to offend every Christians out there. I really don't. But as a kid, this is what I thought. I have tremendous respect for anybody who has a faith that practices, you know, nonviolence, and I'm not trying to single out faith indirectly by saying that. I'm just saying if your religion is like, I like to kill puppies, then I don't support your religion. Right. So, you know, I'm just saying broadly that, yeah, I definitely have respect for people who have faith. I don't have respect for people when they try to take rules of their faith and try to stick it into law, because that's tantamount to Sharia law, which I don't want in America. And I see that happening a lot. It's very disturbing to me as a person who does not want other religious people putting their religious rules on the public at large, because they think that there is some mystical, magical creature who's going to judge us all after the fact. And since I don't think that, you don't get to put that on me. However, I can respect that you do, and you can think that all day. And I get a little controversial when they say that, but it's something I'm passionate about. I don't you know, I'm a big believer in separation of church and state, and I think our founding fathers really did want that, and it's very obvious in all the letters, and even though it's not, you know, clearly written that way in the Constitution, I'm digressing a little bit because I'm talking about religion, but anyway, back to my dad. So
yes.
he married my mother, and then he had, as a minister, what happens is you get a call. So this, I'm getting back to Odessa. So you'll get a call, and I could never understand it because they would talk about it like it was a mystical call from the Lord, but then it's actually a phone call from the bishop. So as a kid, I remember thinking, well, we're just waiting on a call from God. I'm like, okay, is God going to call us? And I didn't realize that that was kind of religious speak for a call from the bishop to tell us what church my dad's going to. So the choices were China or Texas, and I wanted to go to China. I wanted to go to China because as long as they had hamburgers – and as a kid, I was girl crazy, and I thought, well, as long as they have cute girls and hamburgers, you know, I was, what, 12 years old or something, because my dad was graduating seminary, and I used to go to class with him at Wartburg Seminary, and I remember driving around. He had to do, for his finals, he had to drive around to different churches and guest preach, and so when I was, like, I guess 7, 8, 9, I forget, years old, I would ride around the Iowa countryside and guest, you know, hang out with him and watch him guest preach. You know, different churches. And I will say this, regardless of how I feel about religion, one thing that's fascinating about my dad more than any other minister I've ever met, and this is much to my chagrin as his son a little bit, because it put me on the outs sometimes, especially when you're an adopted son, you really have a hole in your heart for that attention. But my dad is such a committed minister. He really does walk the Jesus walk, despite any conflict he and I have had, you know, which we have because he's my father, and all fathers and sons argue and fight. But as far as like actually living the life of Jesus, he does it. I mean, he really does. If he comes to New York when I was visiting me, we're stopping on the street talking to homeless people. He's getting up in the middle of the night to go to somebody who's dying. He's giving away my toys to refugees.
I respect it.
But, we, you know, right. For example, I did not understand, like, we'd have refugees staying with us and he's giving my toys away. I didn't understand as a kid that these refugees had nothing. And that was never really explained to me. So I would get mad. I'm like, wait a second. What? I didn't understand my American entitlement in the poor household I was growing up with. I already felt poor, that we had Vietnamese refugees staying with us. We had, you know, we were doing, you know, Jesus's work, whether I liked it or not, without much explanation to me. And so on the one hand, I tremendously respected him. And I've never met another minister who really downplays the money and really walks the walk, you know, in his professional life, regardless of what my dad has done in his personal life, which is going to stay off the record. I'm not trying to imply that he's done anything horrible. I'm just saying that my point is that people's professional lives can be, you know, perfect, and they might have flaws themselves that, you know, maybe my dad wasn't a perfect father to his daughters or me or whatever, and no dad is. But as far as his religious attitude, he really did it, I think. You know, his church is not full of wealthy people. And I'm not saying wealthy people don't need God or don't need religious support. He was not concerned with the people who had it. He was concerned with bringing in drug addicts, bringing in prostitutes. Everything that Jesus did in terms of, you know, what it says in the Bible about, you know, dealing with the riffraff of the city instead of the elite, my dad was doing. And he really living that walk. So to his credit, I can say that. In that regard, and that was frustrating for me as a kid because I did not understand that, especially when you really really want a dad to just be your dad and make you feel special. His attitude is so Jesus-like; he's making everybody feel special. So that affected, and that actually had some effect on how I felt strongly about the character and how people kind of misinterpreted how I claimed ownership of the character, which I don't. I'm talking about Goku, but I don't own it, and I'm not the only guy that's ever played, and I don't think that. But we're gonna get to that in part two, because a lot of people are just flat out wrong and misunderstand me. And frankly, you know, when you blindly attack me like that on Twitter, you're just as much of a dick as you think I am. So if those of you are listening and you did that, yeah, I think you are. But if I'm attacking you, it makes me a dick. So at the end of the day,
when you
do all the math, you have to forgive everybody because everybody's human and making mistakes. I can go through the whole who's a dick process all day. And eventually, you know, I don't think there's anybody. It's very rare that you find somebody who's just really maliciously trying to be, for the sake of being mean. So even trolls and haters, I know, have big hearts inside, and I know they probably have their own sensitivities and their own foible and their own backgrounds that, you know, you got to forgive them for. And so I try to my knee-jerk reaction is screw you, asshole. But, you know, when I think about it, you know, I go, well, look, they're human. They got feelings. they have their own passions. They, you know, they have their own mistakes they're making, and you know, maybe I can help clarify that with some of this interview. So the choices were China and Texas. And my dad, I think my mom did not want to go to China, so we went to Texas. And here's the weird thing about going to Odessa, Texas. In 1980, I moved to Odessa. First of all, it is like moving to another planet. I remember when we arrived, it was 114 or 104 degrees. The place reeked of petroleum, and there were locusts everywhere. So I thought I was on another planet. I mean, it was like you hear locusts everywhere. You smell petroleum everywhere because they're mining oil like crazy. There's money everywhere because everybody's making money off oil. My dad's in this small church. I was obsessed with football at the time, so I wanted to play football, Pop Warner football. Little did I know, I was moving to the football mecca of the world. And all that shit on Friday Night Lights is true. I lived that. I played football there. I didn't play for Permian, but I played football in junior high. And had I continued to play, I eventually quit football and started playing, being a band, I would have played for Odessa High, which was the underdog. My brother went to Permian briefly, and I had a junior high school sweetheart who went to Permian. And I had a lot of friends that went to Permian, which was the main mojo football team. But that whole football cult, and I'm not putting that word in quotes. As far as I'm concerned, it is a cult, and I don't mean that necessarily in a derogative way.
Right.
And it was. I remember when he arrived, they said, "Hey, do you want to go to a football scrimmage with Permian and some other team?" Man, there were camera crews there for high school football. There was a high school stadium built by Ross Perot, and I had to march in it, and they had every single junior high band and every both high school bands. And if you find a picture of it, there's an overhead shot, and it was the day they opened the stadium. It had AstroTurf for a high school stadium, and it says America spelled out with all the band members. I'm in that photo standing at the bottom of the C, maybe, or in the middle. I'm at the bottom by the sideline with my French horn. I was in Crockett Junior. So that was eighth grade when they opened that stadium for high school football. That's how much money was involved in high school football. And so the second we arrived, they were talking about the church members were talking about football, and it was all football. But what happened was, is I quit football because the coaches were basically assholes and the band directors were nice. So anyway, so we're in Odessa, Texas. It's like football. I joined band because I heard a voice in my head that said I needed to play the French horn. It was really weird. It was like just a mystical voice. At 5 minutes earlier, I had told my friend Wesley that I thought band was for sissies and I was going to join sports, and I hadn't figured out what my other. I literally walked 10 feet away from him and I knew I had to play this horn. And then I think it was because I'd seen the movie Fame and that kid was playing French horn on the toilet. He was playing Mozart's third horn concerto, third movement on the toilet. And I thought that was cool. And I think when I heard that sound, I linked it up with other times I'd heard the sound of the horn in movies and in classical music. And the horn usually represents the hero. And it's a very heroic instrument. And Robert Schumann referred to the French horn as the soul of the orchestra. So it really resonated for me in terms of a hero type motif for me. And then I really got excited about it and just got really serious about playing the horn. I feel for me that ties through because Goku's such a hero character, and to me, the hero essence of it for me is very much like the horn is for me. If that makes sense.
So when you discovered the horn, did you know at that time like, okay, I want to be a pro horn player. I want to do this. I want to play. Is that what you wanted to do back then?
Yeah. Probably from the time I picked it up. I think when I picked it up. I was really excited about it. And then, you know, you play for a year or 9 months and then summer hits. So my first year, you know, it was the first thing I'd ever done really good at. Like, I remember my first few French horn tests where they test you for buzzing, they test you for pitch. I got perfect scores on, and I was really surprised that I had any kind of talent in this area. We did have a bugle around the house that my aunt had given us that I noodled around on a couple of times. And I did have a kind of a natural ability to manipulate physical instruments, and I'd also sung in choir in church, and singing is a big part of church, etc. And so I had some, you know, a little bit of background. But it was what happened was in the summer I kind of got lazy and didn't care, and then all of a sudden solo and ensembles come up, and my band director at the time, my first band director, was telling me, who was a huge influence, great guy in my life. I'm not talking about the other one, but I'm talking about the first one, and his wife, who was my first French horn teacher, were like surrogate parents for me. You know, they were really really kind to me, and my first horn teacher had studied with one of the great, probably one of the greatest horn teachers of the 20th century, which is Philip Farkas, and she'd gone to school and studied with him. And so I was studying with somebody as a beginner who had studied with the best known horn player and teacher in America at the time. And so that was a really great education I got in that regard. But I remember thinking, yeah, I want to do this. I want to be the greatest horn player ever. I want to do this the rest of my life. I love this. I didn't want to study in school. I made terrible grades. All I wanted to do was music. People would say about a backup plan. I said, I don't need a backup plan. I'm doing this. I hate backup. I hate insecurity, and I hate backup plans. When parents get scared, I hate it when I meet a fan who wants to do something dangerous and scary. And by dangerous and scary, I mean a risky career. I'm not talking about base jumping.
Yeah.
I'm talking about, yeah, but I just want to be an actor. But my mom wants me to go to law school. And I'm like, look,
go
I don't want to argue
it,
with your mom, but – you know, to do what you really love in life and not be controlled by your parents or their wishes or their fears takes a lot of balls and a lot of FUs to people who are trying to, they mean well, and they want to, you know, steer you in the right way because they're scared. But by doing so, they take away your dreams and freedom.
That's right.
And I'm a big believer. On the one hand, I don't want to squash somebody's dreams because I have met people who want to be voice actors and then they do an impression for me and it's terrible. But on the other hand, I bump into some really genuinely talented people who have very controlling parents and they're scared to say, hey, I really don't want to go to accounting school. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with lawyers and accountants and stuff. I have tremendous respect for those jobs. I used to want to be a lawyer. They're just jobs I'm not good at because I'm better at this. And they're standard jobs that people, you know, doctor, lawyer, accountant, you know, jobs that make money.
Jobs that your parents want you to have, right?
Yeah, that your parents want you to have that of security, you know. Every once in a while I'll meet cool parents who are like, yeah, man, my son's going to be a rock star. I got him a guitar when he was six. I'm like, all right. Maybe they don't want to be a rock star. Maybe they want to be an accountant or like that kid in the Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer wanted to be a dentist. You know, the elf that wanted to be a dentist. I always thought that was funny. But there's a lot of willfulness on my part. I was a very intense kid. I was very had a lot of energy, and I definitely
you still do.
I had a very difficult time emotionally regulating. I would lose my cool a lot, and maybe that's why I'm a little bit reactive as I got older. But that's always been kind of my my personality, and I'm not always proud of it. As I feel very strongly about things, you know, and I sometimes can't handle how strongly I feel about something, you know, like it's, and I think that's why I like Dragon Ball so much in the sense that to me, I remember thinking when I was running track, I was a pretty fast runner. And I remember thinking no matter how fast I was moving my legs, maybe I could move them one little bit faster every time. And there was no limit to that, which is funny because as a fan of quantum mechanics, especially, you know, there's no matter how many times you divide something in half, half's always left. And there's no, even though there's a speed of light limit, we don't know that there's any other limits, you know, once you get past that sort of situation, because they have detected faster than light objects and or subatomic particles in space before. So I'm always thinking that, well, as long as you can add one to it, you know, no matter how big something is, you can always add one. And no matter how many times you divide it in half, half's always left. I'm thinking in limitlessness, and I'm thinking, okay, well, you know, so when it comes to Dragon Ball, okay, I screamed this loud this season. We're just going to keep going. There's no, I don't care. We're just going to rip it apart to where it's just, you know, and Dragon Ball epitomizes that. And that's something I've felt about life, you know, from running and anything else I could do, play louder, higher, faster, no limits. Granted, there are limits. I just don't like to acknowledge them. But yeah. I think if you acknowledge them, you're going to lose half your limits because if you don't acknowledge them, you know, you could hurt yourself, but if you don't acknowledge them also, you're still open to the possibility of a higher level. So if you set up a limit ahead of time, you've already cut yourself off. But if you decide there's no limits, then you'll find out what the real limit is when you try really hard. So
that's very inspirational.
You know what I'm saying?
No, and I agree with you because I deal with that a lot. And what I do, you know, I so many people want to become self-employed or just, you know, do a job that's not what their parents wanted. And I'm always like, go for it. I mean, you know, if you slip and fall, pick yourself up and try again. But there's always that toxic fear. You know what I mean? That they're afraid of failing.
Well, it's toxic fear. And the people – and I'm a big fan of Anthony Robbins. I did his tapes half-assed when I was just sitting on the couch figuring out what the hell I want to do with my life. And it changed my life. Well, he gets a lot of flack, but there's a lot of his stuff that worked really well for me in terms of you know, awakening the giant within, realizing your full potential, finding your own true destiny. And the rock band Rush, I've mentioned them many times, is hugely influential on me. I didn't realize at the time Neil Peart had been influenced by Ayn Rand, and I made the mistake of trying to read The Fountainhead and Thich Nhat Hanh's Being Peace at the same time, and I can tell you the books are pretty much opposite of each other. you know, I have critically analyzed Ayn Rand quite a bit, and I have to say some of it's just, you know, a lot of it's just, I think it's bullshit, but I don't agree with it. We're you know, it's dangerous for humanity.
Right.
So, you know, that's just my opinion. And you know, and I'm influenced by a lot of different things. Look, at the end of the day, the way I really look at humans is that we're fancy computers and it's garbage in, garbage out. And there's a bit of code in there that's your DNA that affects it. And the nature nurture argument, it's usually 50-50. But, you know, you stick a kid in a racist household, he's probably going to grow up racist. You stick a kid in an enlightened household, he's probably going to grow up more enlightened, unless he really hates his parents and rebels the opposite. You abuse a kid, he might grow up being an abuser. You treat a kid nice, he's going to grow. I mean, it's garbage in, garbage out.
Yes,
50-50. And the fact that we're sold this idea that somehow it's not that is just absolutely ridiculous to me. And there's a certain body of science that's emerging, that is validating this more and more and more. So at the end of the day, I don't think we're driving the bus, which, by the way, I can prove that to some degree. I remember sitting in a subway in Manhattan and looking over the shoulder of some woman who was obviously working on her marketing degree, and I was looking at her textbook, and there were some frightening things in there about how they figure out what we're going to buy. In other words, if I described you, Mr. Geekdom, as a giant algorithm, and I knew enough data about you, you know, A squared plus B squared, I can predict what C squared is, which is you're probably going to buy this product based on all this other data. And they're right big percentage of the time. What does that say about free will and our unconscious? It says we're not driving the bus.
No.
You know?
The algorithm of YouTube is the same way. If you start watching Dragon Ball videos, all of a sudden Dragon Ball videos pop up everywhere. It's just how it is. It's everywhere. The psychologists that these companies pay, like I remember reading that, you know, the reason why McDonald's uses yellow and red is because the yellow and red color is supposed to make you hungry.
Oh, when you walk into, and I read an article about this recently, when you walk into a McDonald's, your brain is literally, and I'm not using literally as a metaphor or as a putting it in quotes, your brain is literally hijacked. You think you want McDonald's. You think you want to buy McDonald's. You think you want to eat McDonald's. No, you don't. Your brain is your basal stem or your brain stem is being hijacked indirectly. And then these companies, I don't know if McDonald's is one of them, but politicians with these companies will sell you the idea that it was your choice and your free will after they've taken that choice from you. Yeah. So it is a existential inception-y world we're living in, and where you think, and what's funny about this, philosophically, well, what's funny about this, if it's philosophical, and I have many lawyer friends for some reason, and I love talking about the law, is the founding fathers and early law professors. Here's what's interesting to me. Think about this philosophy, okay? Oftentimes a judge or a jury member or a attorney general, perhaps, might have to recuse themselves from a trial due to bias. Well, wait a second. If we really have free will and I'm really in control of what my thoughts and feelings are, I shouldn't have to recuse myself for bias. Basically, when you recuse yourself from bias, you're saying, oh, I know the defendant. We had a relationship, so I could be biased.
Right.
Well, if you're driving the bus, you wouldn't be biased. So you're obviously not driving the bus. And early law philosophers, Thomas Jefferson, other people who are you know, basically underpinning the structure of how law would become, other famous law people I'm not familiar with, were aware of this. And they knew that people could be influenced. And so we know this, yet the public and the average person sitting on the couch going, these are my decisions, my life, and I'm making my decisions. No, you're not.
You're not.
And that's something I philosophically struggle with myself. Like, am I buying this thing because I want it, or did I see a commercial for? Like, who's driving the bus?
No,
the older I get, the more. And remember, in my 30s, I was vehemently opposed to the concept of non-free will. And how I arrived at this decision was thinking about it a lot, all these other things. Plus, I knew a Buddhist monk who studied Kung Fu, is a friend of mine, and we would talk about Buddhist philosophy because I was reading a lot of Buddhist texts at the time, and she would argue with me about free will, and I was just, you know, such an ego. I was like, no, free will, no, no, no. And then the more and more I thought about it, and the more and more I analyzed it, and the more and more I went into my own kind of meditative states, I realized that, you know, I don't think that we're driving the bus as much as we think we are, and advertisers know this.
Yeah.
And judges who recuse themselves know this, yet everybody walks around like, well, you know, vote your conscience, vote. You know, this is why the Russians were trying to influence the election, because they know we're not driving the bus. They're not even driving. We could probably influence their elections if we wanted to. Maybe we are. I doubt we are. But maybe we are. The point is that I'm imploring anybody who's a thinking person to really second guess yourself and really try to figure out what your truth is. And a lot of times I figure that out by doing a lot of trial and error, a lot of experimentation going back and forth. For example, when I shop, I will research the shit out of everything that I want to buy.
Me too.
And I analyze it and memorize all the data. And then a lot of times when I go in to finally buy, I'll buy the opposite thing just because my gut at the last second goes, you think you want this, but what you really want is this. And then most of the time I'm right. And whatever it is I'm buying, whether it's a preamp or a guitar or socks, you know, I have analyzed it to death to where I'm trying to make sure that I'm buying what I really want instead of what people want me to buy. It makes me mad that any other humans or group are trying to do that and control that. So,
hey, Apple's been doing it for years. I was just saying,
I'm the only guy, dude. I think I'm the only guy that I have an iPhone now. I didn't want one. I didn't like it. I don't like the Apple Watch. I think it's a waste of time. I'm always poking a hole at it because, even when the iPad came out, my signature was sent from my iPad, not a mystical, magical, game-changing device, but a pretty cool keyboardless computer.
I don't think
it's as mystical, magical as everybody else thinks it is, because I'm looking at it for what it really is. And you know what's really weird is that philosophy of mine. My dad, even though he's a minister and very spiritual, he was a valedictorian, has a really strong background in science, and is really, really smart. And I've noticed that he's a deconstructionist also. And the way he uses his deconstructionism is to evangelize Christianity to other people. So that's how he, you know, he's not a converter necessarily. He does it in a very humble way. He's not like a televangelist or something like that. But he deconstructs. He's a great deconstructionist. And so I tend to deconstruct. I tend to be a deconstructionist in my approach to things and trying to find the difference between the fluff and the substance. And it's a hard thing to do when especially nowadays when we're being bombarded by Twitter feeds and social media and YouTube, and we're more connected than ever. Before, I might sound like an old person, but I miss the days to where if I did an interview like this and I said something stupid, which I probably already have, and then I don't have to worry about some idiot quoting me out of context 10 years later when I've grown and changed and no longer feel that way. And this happens to politicians all the time, and it makes me sad.
It happens to everybody.
Well, because a politician might be a dipshit in the 80s, and then he grows and changes and becomes a more mature politician, and then he's running for president. They go, well, maybe in 1980 you said this horrible thing. You're the same person. Well, maybe they're not. Stop it.
You could have a disagreement with somebody 3 years ago, and people will still throw it in your face, even if you and that person are best friends. It's ridiculous. And the thing
is, you go ahead.
No, I was just going to say.
No, I've talked way too much, and I'm not letting you talk.
No,
sorry,
it's your interview, man. But I do find it interesting, though, that, you know, like the film They Live by John Carpenter. I don't know. I don't believe that the world's really being run by aliens, even though that's a whole different topic. But that being said, there's a lot of, I think people have to understand, there's a lot of very intelligent people that understand human behavior, human psychology, that work for these companies, and that's why they're programming us on television. And again, it's not like I'm trying to be a conspiracy guy, but they get paid very good money to do this. You know?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, the best way to see it best articulated is watch any magician who's a mentalist. If you watch a magician, there's one guy I think of, it's not David Blaine, there's magicians who do those tricks where, you know, they take up a group of people on a tour and they ask them to write a piece of paper, or they do this, and they predict what they've written because they took them on a tour where they knew they would see these balloons and it would unconsciously influence them. So they'd write this color on the piece of paper, but they knew they were going to do that. Mentalists are always playing on this all the time. And so what I implore, you know, anybody who's a consumer of art or anything, particularly Dragon Ball fans, to be aware of that and know that when you're making your decisions about, you know, your life and where you spend your money and who you vote for, et cetera, that mentalists are aware of this and they exploit it all the time. So, you know, when I go to magic shows, I'm always looking for I always try to poke a hole and see if I can figure out what the magician's, you know, doing. And I love magic shows for that sleight of hand. And even with mentalists, they're trying to say, okay, I knew you were going to do that. Well, he knew he was going to do that because he influenced me subconsciously before that, because he knows how to influence someone's unconscious. Furthermore, they did a study years ago where they were talking about micro expressions and they tested these Buddhist monks against judges and lawyers. Now, judges and lawyers and police officers are trained to look for body language and micro gestures that reveal tells that, you know, for a criminal they're interviewing. And these are micro expressions that you might be able to see with a freeze frame on a high speed camera, or you might be able to pick up unconsciously. And they tested these Buddhist to see if they're lying, to see if they're misdirecting. And they tested these Buddhist monks against these judges, lawyers who'd been meditating for like 20 or 30 years or whatever. And I think they were from Thailand or something. It's an article I read many years ago. And the Buddhist monks got it right way more than the judges and lawyers and police officers, who get it right more than the average person because they're trained to do it.
Right.
So, you know, through calm meditation, you can study and focus, you can finally see through the true nature of what our brains are doing. So all this thinking and analysis, by the way, I'd like to point out, I try to bring to what I'm doing on Dragon Ball. So when someone says, I don't know the character, I don't know this, I'm like, dude, don't think I'm not thinking about this.
The bottom line is you care. Like, that's the thing. No matter what, if people can criticize your lines, this line didn't sound good, that did, whatever they want to say, at the end of the day, you put your all into this character and to every character. Yeah, that's the important thing.
Well, and the thing is like, is remember, I was doing the role, and we'll talk about this more in part two. I'm getting the role from a Canadian actor who I've been asked to mimic, who, you know, didn't necessarily get, I don't know what their audition process was like, but I know Akira Toriyama didn't come to Canada to help them flesh out the voice, that's for sure.
Right.
And so in an ideal scenario, when you're auditioning for a show, I'm going to go over this briefly, even though this is really for part two, maybe it'll segue us into part two, but the ideal scenario when you're doing a prelay show in America, and I've done this on several cartoons, I did it with Kappa Mikey, I did it with another animation thing with some Academy Award winning director, and the animation never got made, but I remember it was supposed to be a big deal, and I don't remember his name, but it was a big deal like 10 years ago. You go into audition, and you know, after you audition, or if it's a pilot, you usually meet with the creator. Usually you'll meet with the director for sure, who's definitely meeting with the creator if you're not meeting with the creator, and they're there in the first few sessions, and possibly the first season, to help you flesh out that voice and make sure it's, you know, exactly where they want it, right? So I'm guessing Matt Groening was there in the early Simpsons days, and you know, and it probably is still there. And those voices did slowly solidify and change over the years, because if you listen to the Simpsons voices on the Tracy, she's one of my favorites.
You're talking about when they were on before they had their own show.
Yeah, Tracy. God dang, I have to ask my girlfriend. Hang on a second.
No,
Bean. What was it, Tracy?
Well, there you go. Everyone.
The Simpsons were on the first episode.
Ullman.
Tracy Ullman.
Ullman.
Is it Ullman? A L L M A N.
Ullman.
You, Ullman. Tracy Ullman. Yes. Ullman. God, I don't know why. She's one of my favorites, and I her name never slips. Thank you. Never slips my tongue. But when it was a short on her show, I saw that the day it aired. I remember watching her show because I liked her. And I watched, and this cartoon came on, and I was like, what the hell is this? This, and I was a teenager at the time, so I'm like, this is awesome. Like, I could not believe that, you know, they had a dad choking a kid, you know, in anger on a comedy show. And I thought it was hilarious and awesome. And then as those actors, you know, got into their roles more, they fell into the pocket that they would basically stay in, which just happens a lot on shows. I mean, that happens, you know, all the time, you know. The productions don't have the time or budget to say, okay, we're going to work on these voices for 26 weeks before we actually record anything. Like, nobody can do that, right? I mean, they could, but it'd be totally, you know, not cost effective at all. So, you know, the parameters I was under was, here's a show you don't know anything about. We're trying to make it American style, Americanized. It's your first job. You're copying a Canadian cast member. You haven't even heard the Japanese. You can't even hear the Japanese. You're grabbing at straws to get whatever you can to make this, honor this character the way you can and keep it vocally consistent. And then some fan is going to give me shit about that when they don't even know, like, what the parameters I was in. The ideal scenario would have been that, you know, either they kept it in Canada the whole time and kept a consistent cast, which I would have been okay with because I would never have known that I was going to be Goku, et cetera, et cetera.
Different life path.
It's a different life path, right? So, you know, if you're going to do it, my attitude is always keep the same cast, always keep it consistent no matter what. But if you got to switch it, yes, you want to keep it vocally, or if an actor dies, which has happened, you want to keep it vocally consistent. But the parameters and the restraints I was under when I first started doing Z were very, very difficult to navigate. And I didn't even know how difficult they were to navigate until I had 20/20 hindsight here doing this interview with you, et cetera, et cetera. So,
yeah,
you know, if you're going to get, you know, plus it also speaks to the issue of, you know, modern day Twitter and stuff like that. You know, when I was growing up, you didn't just walk into somebody's job and tell them they sucked in public, which is essentially what happens on Twitter. And it's not that I can't take constructive criticism. It's just that I'm not going to do anything with it, even if I think you're right, because I'm playing Goku and you're not. And I don't want to have 50 hands in the pot controlling me. I already got, you know, the hands, I'm trying to get, you know, as much of Akira Toriyama in there. I don't necessarily think that the original dub cast is necessarily the gold standard for how I should interpret it, because it's a completely different language. And it's a completely different culture. So I don't agree with that. I'm trying to make it palatable to not only fans, but also people who might have never heard of it before. So there's, you know, and we'll go into this more later because I'm probably leaving out some details that will make people
We'll discuss that later. What I wanted to ask you actually was, transitioning into voice, did playing the French horn with, like, the breathing techniques and the fact that you're performing, even though it's with an instrument, not with your voice, did it give you, like, an extra skill set that was helpful when you did voice?
Absolutely, because voice breath support and brass playing breath support is pretty much identical. And so when you're blowing through a 12.5-foot tube, or I forget how long the F side is, there's 12.5 feet on the F side, 8.25 or something on the B flat. I didn't remember the length of the tube. But when you're blowing through that for 20 years, excuse me, plus I was a vocal minor, plus I was singing in choir every Sunday, plus I had been a choir director for my dad, and I always believe in standing, and I always believe in using diaphragmatic breath support, plus, you know, developing your ear for a sensitivity of tonality, tonal quality, doing mimicry, really developing your ear and understanding how it works with a microphone and understanding how to use mic technique, all that. So I felt like the audition process was extremely easy because I've been doing voices my whole life at that point. It was much easier than a French horn audition. Trust me, a classical music audition, multiple rounds of a classical music audition is way harder than any voice audition I've ever done. And I'm not slighting actors and I'm not slighting people who work on this craft. But as far as auditions I've ever done, going through the process of being screened for a symphony job is much more grueling than a voiceover audition because there are multiple rounds. It's very physical. It's screened. You are playing some very, very difficult intellectual pieces of music, emotional pieces of music. You know, you're reading music, playing things from memory. You're dealing with performance anxiety. You're performing, behind a screen on stage in front of, you know, five judges, one of whom is a very well-known maestro that you got to impress. It's very different than going into a studio and they're like, just give us what you got, see what you're going on, all right? And then you do, okay, that's nice. It's always real. Auditions are much more friendly process for voiceover. And about 80% to 90% of what I learned in classical music translated over to, the mouth flaps were the conductor. So matching flap was easy. I'd been matching flaps since I was a kid because I was dubbing shows in real time. So to me, and what was really exciting to me was when you're playing the horn on stage, you don't get a take two. You better get it right the first time or else. With voiceover, I was like, I got that wrong. I can do that 100 times, but you get it right? Cool. So when I first started, it would take me anywhere from 12 to 20 or 30 times to get a take right. Now I get a take right, and then I've done it for 20 years in 1 to 3 times. So I usually don't have to do a third take. Sometimes I nail it the first time along with while they're playing the Japanese. They'll be playing the Japanese in my ear for timing. And for the record, I don't take influence, and people get all mad when I do it. I tried it. It doesn't work. She's speaking a different language. She has a different tonality. Yeah. The inflections don't work. I tried it. Muska will be in my ear, and I'm doing my own inflections, and I'm just looking at flap and listening to the timing. But I oftentimes will do it in real time with the Japanese, and if I don't get it right that time, I usually get it on the second take. But that's after 20 years of practice and working in New York and 4 kids and all the shows I did there and working for Michael Cinder Nicholas, et cetera, et cetera. So I worked in New York, L.A., and Texas for different production houses. And so it cracks me up when people, it's not that I can't take flack, but it cracks me up that, people keep hiring me and people seem to do a good job and I've won some awards and yet, you still want to give me shit. I'm like, look, I guess you can and you have a right to your own opinion, but I'm not going to go, at Blazin420 says, I suck. I guess I better change my performance. Like, I look at my Twitter feed, like, you think you're going to affect me? No, I'm just going to go, that guy's mean. Block him or don't pay attention to him forever. Like, right. I hate this world we live in like that. It's made us all a bunch of jerks. And look, I'm not perfect. I've said some shit online I totally regret. And I've deleted it. And I want it gone forever. But some jerk has to, come up and say, well, you remember you said this? I go, yeah, and I was embarrassed. And so I don't want to be reminded of it because I'm trying to grow as a human being. So maybe you could not remind me of it so I can forget that I was screwed up back then and maybe be nice to people and not do that anymore. So, I can grow as a person and maybe you could grow too by not repeating it and throwing it into the conversation on a thread that it doesn't belong, such as, Toye announces something by me and then they have to tweet something when I'm not going to repeat it, but they have to tweet something, out of context that they think I said was negative that I didn't. Man, I got nothing. Toya gave me my whole freaking life. I have nothing but respect and admiration for Toya and Akira Toriyama-sama. They call him Akira Toriyama-sensei. I don't know exactly what he's teaching us, but I prefer to call him Sama because to me that's like the highest thing. But I think the Japanese honorific, I always hear that the Japanese clients referring to him as sensei, which is probably the proper honorific. And I'm half jesting here. But, yeah, I mean, look, I got a whole – I'm having this interview with you. I, you know, despite the fans that, you know, give me shit, the vast majority of them, you know, constantly telling me I'm their childhood, I can't tell you how overwhelming and humbling and gratifying that is. And it's still, I still never walk away with it like, ah, yes, I am great. I'm Goku. I still go, oh, shit, was it good enough? Oh, shit. You know, am I getting it right? You know, and I want to do it right. But remember, I never even picked this voice. It slowly evolved into my voice. But I was trying to mimic an artistic choice another actor had made. And we're going to talk more about that in detail in part two of this annoyingly long interview.
no, it's still good. I actually want to talk about some nerd stuff with you.
Yeah, let's do some nerd stuff.
All right. Who were some of your favorite composers of all time?
Let's see. That's
musically
a big question.
Yeah.
Well, okay, as a hornist, you know, I'm going to go with horn composers. So you've got Richard Strauss. Johann's okay, but he does the waltzes, but Richard does his own waltzes in Der Rosenkavalier and other things. I love Dvorak. I love Sibelius. Well, I only love a little Sibelius, but there's one particular symphony that's really means a lot to me. So Sibelius, Symphony Number 2, Dvorak 9. I love Mahler. I like a lot of Strauss. Strauss was a horn player. Franz Strauss was Richard Wagner's principal horn, I believe. I like the Mozart. It's weird. I like the Mozart horn concerti. I'm not so into Mozart emotionally as I am. It's interesting because Chris Sabat and I have a very interesting relationship. It's what's funny about me and Chris is we are opposites, but often have the same thought at the same time. And so even when it comes to food, so Chris has told me on occasion that Mozart just makes him so happy. And I find it homogenous and boring sometimes because I understand the harmonic structure. And even though it's genius harmonic structure, and that's been proven scientifically, and Mozart was a genius, the fact that it's so homogenous and so mathematically perfect, I can hear that, and that it's missing some of the romantic period passion to me that Chopin and Beethoven in particular, Mahler has, Strauss has, that is, you know, more dissonant chords. Less, you know, and sometimes in a Mozart piece, you'll just hear a basic run on a major scale. You're like, dun, da, 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 da. You know, that to me is just like boring math. You know, I'm just like, okay. So I like the Mozart horn concerti pretty well. But as a composer, I'm not as into Mozart. I like Bach a lot, but Bach is also not as you know, the choir stuff is pretty passionate. But, you know, I like a lot of this stuff is very mathematical. There's a book called Gödel, Escher, Bach, which compares the mathematical influences of the mathematician Gödel, Escher, the painter M.C. Escher, and Bach. I remember reading that in high school. My dad was reading it, and there's a lot of interesting mathematical parallels. I remember when I was in music school, we were analyzing a Beethoven sonata, measure by measure. You have to analyze them quarterly, measure by measure. And I remember being, you know, astounded at the mathematical. And I'm not even that good at math, but I remember being astounded at the mathematical. What was astounding to me about the sonata was that it was sonically beautiful, but also mathematically beautiful as well, which was really surprising to me, similar to a Shakespeare sonnet. You know what I'm saying? So classically, that's kind of a rundown. I'm trying to think if there's anybody I missed. I love, as far as horn concerti, my favorites are Strauss's second horn concerto, the Hindemith concerto. There's a couple other things I really like. Serenade for Tenor, Horn, and Strings. Benjamin Britten is, of course, another one. I'm a huge Dennis Brain fan. Probably the greatest horn player that ever lived. He died in a car wreck in 1957. I can geek out on classical music. Is it's funny because classical, when you learn music theory and you learn voice leading and harmony, you listen to classical music and all of a sudden your brain feels kind of unlocked. But then I'll listen to like a Rodgers and Hammerstein musical or some other musical where a lot of people really like it, and I'm hearing all what we call are the mistakes. And what's funny is people say, well, they're not mistakes. You just feel it. It's music. No, they're mistakes. But they're not necessarily wrong. Meaning, I was always curious about that in music school, so I always thought it was interesting. What happens with a lot of the musical rules, particularly in Bach's time, is that it's a mistake that's turned into a rule, such as a passing tone or a suspended tone. So a lot of times what will happen is, you know, Bach's conducting his choir, or he's got his instrumentation set up for whatever church gig he's at and whatever year it is. I can't remember exactly the dates of Bach, but it's the beginning of the common practice period, which is from 16-something to 1900 or some shit. And somebody will hold a note too long in the choir, but it sounds cool. Bach goes, hey, that sounds cool. And then he makes it a rule, And then, and I don't know, if, I'm not saying this is necessarily a fact, but this is a metaphorical example, but I remember them talking about this in music school. And so you have a suspended tone, or you have a passing tone or something, where someone went to the tone too soon, but the dissonance made a cool effect, and then Bach goes, oh, I'm going to use that again. That's a rule. That's now called a passing tone. That kind of shit happens all the time. And so when I hear, like, voice leading issues, you know, in a musical that I'm playing, and I hear the problems with it, it hurts my ear because you're so trained. Like, I like that band Girl Talk, but they're really stretching the limit on how you can mash songs together. And people say, oh, this mashup is perfect, and it's not, and it hurts my head. And I'm like, no, you got this chord sitting on top of this chord, and they clash big time sonically. That does not go together, and you're stretching the bounds of what fits on top of each other. Although I will say that pretty much Rick Astley's two hits do fit on top of each other harmonically, because I tried it when they came out. But yeah, that's where I'm at sonically. Is I'm into the pitch and the music and theory, and I'm also into the harmonics of a voice. So a lot of times, if I'm doing a voice or I'm listening to a voice, I'm listening to the structure of the voice and how it's coming out of the character. But I'm also listening to the partials and harmonics that might be involved in that. So, like, for example, there's a couple of low monster voices I do that are really super low, but it's the higher partials and harmonics that I try to mix in when I'm doing an audition, that the crackly parts that are real crispy, that actually make it sound sinister, not that it's low. And I've heard this with other actors. They go, oh yeah, guy's got a really great deep low voice, and actually it's not that low and deep. It just has these other harmonics in it that make it sound that way, and it's not that way. So I don't know, I'm digressing about sound and stuff, but for me, when I watch Dragon Ball, I'm listening to, or when I watch any show, I'm listening to a lot of things: how they say stuff, the quality of their voice, the tone of their voice, the mix of the voice, the mix of everything, and how it all comes together sonically, and how, you know, in the sandwich that they're going into my ears. So I know I'm digressing geekdom. That's just kind of how I, you can see why Chris is frustrated with the voicemails I leave him.
No, it's as long as there's as long as there's space. So I know that you like Star Wars. What do you think about John Williams?
I do like Star Wars. John Williams is probably the last great true classical composer. And what I mean by true classical composer, there's other guys out there who are really great, and I don't want to diss them at all. But what I mean is, you know, if John Williams could easily be transported to the late 1800s, the time period of, well, Beethoven's really kind of in between the classic and romantic period. But he could go, John Williams could easily hang out with Mahler and Holst and Strauss and be a peer of them in terms of the way he composes and I miss in music. I like motif based classical music, and a lot of times I notice a lot of the composers are going for texture and feel, and I find it disconcerting. You've got a string bed, you've got some atmospheric synthesizers, you've got the hero shows up, you've got nothing for the hero, and it's cool and atmospheric. You know, there's a reason there. You know, Luke's theme is played by the horn. That whole thing, that's the horn solo. That's what they call that leitmotif, or whatever, leitmotif. Yeah. And it's heroic. I like that in movies. I want to see more of that. And the tendency in movies right now is to be more atmospheric and textural. And to me, that's, I don't know, I hate to call it lazy because it's not, but it's almost like you've got something in a room that kind of doesn't fit, and then it fits and it adds some air, but it's nonspecific, so your brain's left wondering. And I definitely like specificity, and I like everything to come together. Maybe I'm showing my age, I don't know. But that's how I perceive him. But John Williams is, you know, he actually wrote a horn concerto recently that a friend of mine performed. I think it's a fairly recent concerto, and I haven't heard it all yet. But all my horn peers are like, yeah, it's actually a really good concerto, which is really hard to write a good French horn concerto. There's a lot of them that really suck. But apparently it's a really good, he knows the horn really well. Williams, the very few composers really write for horn in a way that, unless they're horn players themselves, usually don't write for horn very well. And they don't know how to mic horn right either. But there are some that do. And John Williams is definitely one of the best, if not, he's just a living, he's the last of a great generation of, you know, of composers and conductors that, you know, my friend Todd Haberkorn is going to go see, maybe he's already done it, one of his last conducting performances with the LA Phil. I think he's already gone, or maybe maybe he did that earlier. I can't remember when he was going. He asked me if I was going. I said, no, I think I'm out of town that weekend. But yeah, I love John Williams. I love, love a lot of the movie scores. And back in the day, it was real common to buy the movie score, but it's hard to buy a textural movie score that's just texture. It's not, doesn't have a motive or a theme or an exposition or a recapitulation or any, you know, musical thing that, you know, would be interesting to me.
Well, you mentioned Leia earlier. Now, what
was my dog,
yes. What was the story of you meeting Carrie Fisher on an airplane?
So, okay, so, well, the way we got, the dog's a rescue, and she's a mystical, magical dog from another planet. I swear she's psychic. And she, and I've had friends over who've experienced this. This happened with Todd Haberkorn, it happened with another friend of mine. She can feel when you're upset, even if you're not expressing it externally. So if you come over to my house and you just went through a big breakup and you're acting all smiles and you're sitting on the couch and you're having feelings about your breakup, even though you're all smiles, and I can't even tell, she will forcibly climb up on you, stand on your shoulder, and lick your face until you feel better. Like, she will not back down. She's like, no, there's no room for bad feelings in this house. You have to feel good. I can tell. And it happens every single time. So I had bumped into Carrie a couple of times at conventions. Oddly enough, I remember going backstage at Fan Expo, and there was a woman laying on a carpet on the floor with a dog. And I thought, is this a fan that passed out backstage? And it was Carrie Fisher just decided she wanted to lay down back. And I'm talking right behind where we signed, not on a stage anywhere, on the floor. And I chuckled a little bit. And then at that same con, I had a couple of fans come up to me, and they had glitter smeared all over their faces. And I thought it was part of their cosplay. And I go, where'd you get the glitter? And they're like, well, Carrie Fisher smeared it all over me. And I look over, and yeah, she's just taking glitter and smearing it on people's faces. So what happened was I ended up going through security with Carrie Fisher. This is just a few months before she died, and she had her dog with her and her dog's handler, and we're going, I don't know if it was an international flight. I don't know, it was a long flight, and we were at a layover for a bit, and we were just chatting in line, and she was, you know, talking to me about interior decorating and asking me about, you know, my life, and I was talking to her about hers, and, you know, I've met a lot of famous people, and I've met a lot of really amazing artists, some of whom were classical musicians, some of whom were actors, and I've been in the green room with pretty much anybody famous you can think of, with the exception of people like Tom Cruise. But I've met Benedict Cumberbatch. I've been in the green room
with Shatner
several times. Mark Hamill, I've signed next to, and I chatted with Mark Hamill his daughter with Chris Sabat's newborn baby many years ago when Hero was born, backstage at Dallas Fan Expo. We're literally sitting on the ground. Mark Hamill's playing with Chris's kid. Mark Hamill's daughter's there. Mark couldn't be any cooler. He was so amazing. And I just shut up. When I'm around those people, I do not, my rule of thumb around famous people is that, being only this level of famous myself, and people are, you know, often in my space, I'm like, I know they're dealing with it times 100, so I am not going to geek out on them. Even my girlfriend, who loves Bruce Campbell, she was with me at a Fan Expo, and he walked into the green room, and I go say hi to him. She's like, no, I don't want to. So I saw Bruce at a later convention. I said, hey, Bruce, my girlfriend was too shy to get a selfie. And he goes, let's do that selfie. And he just takes my phone from me, takes a picture
That's
of himself,
awesome.
And then hands me the phone back. And he was so – he was amazing.
Awesome.
And some of these celebrities are not cool. But most of them I experienced, Carrie especially included, Mark and Bruce Campbell were just absolutely total princes and princesses and totally cool. And what happened was and Carrie – you know, you meet people in life. I've always, you know, growing up in a spiritual household, and you, every once in a while you bump into people who have kind of a, you feel like they have a sixth sense about you, who you feel like they might be telepathic or psychic or can see right through you. And they make you feel so, I heard Bill Clinton's this way also, that he just has this magic power to make you feel really special. Although I've never met Bill Clinton, but I've heard that story about him. I can say Carrie's that way. You know, any rumors you've heard about her craziness or this, that, or the other, my experience was not that. I think that's total bullshit. She was a kind, loving, respectful, insightful, practically psychic person with me. Like, I really felt like I was talking to a person I had known my whole life, and that
Wow.
she just saw right through me and was cool as shit to me. And we were chatting and talking about Instagram, and her dog is making us laugh. Her dog kept she was sitting behind me in first class. We were both in first class. Her dog kept licking the ice out of the Coke before she could have her Coke. And then when we were walking through security, Carrie goes, let's go get some Burger King fries. There's Burger King. And I'm like, oh, crap, it's closed. So we were going to get Burger King fries. But we were talking about, and she was showing me pictures of her interior decorating. And I was talking about my dog. And, you know, 2 hours into the conversation, you know, she goes, oh, but what's your dog's name? And I have to sheepishly admit that the dog's named Leia, because I was afraid she would think I was some kind of creepy, you know, fan person who wants to Not that those people are bad, by the way. In defense of creepy fan people, we have to admit this. Creepy fan people really do love your stuff, and that's a really beautiful thing. They just don't know how to deal with those emotions sometimes. So I sheepishly admit that it's Leia. But then I explained to her. I said, well, her she's a rescue, and when we got her, her name was Laura Leia, and I was trying to think of something that was easy, that was part of, you know, stuff I was interested in that sounded like Laura Leia, so I didn't have to train her on a new name. So I thought, oh, Princess Leia, Leia, that's perfect. You know, that's, you know, I like Star Wars. It's great.
Right.
So that we had a chuckle about that. And I consider meeting her and talking with her, you know, and I'm sure Mark Hamill can, you know, feels this times a thousand or a million. But for me, as a guy who just had 2 hours or so chatting with her, it was one of the best celebrity and best, you know, interpersonal experiences of my life. That's how cool she was. And that includes, you know, here's a story for you. Having my balls grabbed by Kenny Baker, R2-D2.
he grabbed your testicles.
He totally grabbed my balls. And wow. And I want to put it in my Wikipedia page. I'll tell you one more story. We got to wrap it up here pretty soon. But
yeah.
So I was in a bar in New Zealand in 2003 or 4. And, you know, I told you earlier I have this habit of, like, doing impressions of people right when I meet them. And only in the last few years have I realized that that might be offensive to some people. But at this point, I had not realized that yet. So Kenny Baker had a very high
kind of voice that talked like this, right? He was very British. And he
Chris
had a very
Ayers?
High voice.
No, not Chris Ayers. That sounds like Chris Ayers.
Chris Ayers, yeah.
My Chris Ayers impression is very similar to my Kenny Baker impression. But, and that, of course, doesn't sound like Chris Ayers. And for the record, I love Chris Ayers, but I love exaggerating his voice.
I
love exaggerating his erudite autisteness. Because he's such an artiste, and I have such respect and love for the guy. But Kenny Baker has a very similar, but he has an actual British accent, whereas I'm doing kind of the mid-Atlantic thing with Chris Ayers. But so I'm sitting in a bar with him, and, you know, I kept teasing him about his voice and his accent. And so I kept saying, repeating to him how he told me how he got the part on Star Wars. So I'm sitting next to him, and that guy, I'm not much of a drinker. I don't drink a lot of alcohol, and I'm not really good with liquor, but that guy could drink.
Right.
And he had a martini, big martini, and I was having a drink, and I might have been a little tipsy at this point, but I remember just he's sitting next to me, and he's chatting with someone on his left, and I'm on his right,
and I keep whispering, like, 1977, George Lucas asked me if I wanted to be a part of Star Wars, and I said, I'd love to be a part of Star Wars,
and I kept fucking with him, and then he reaches over and gooses me in the nads to kind of get me to shut up, like, he's fucking with me, right? He's, you know, he's goofing around. He gooses me.
Yeah.
He's like, you know, stop it. And I laugh and I go, oh my God, R2-D2 grabbed my balls. I'm never washing them. Actually, I'll probably wash them, but R2-D2 grabbed my balls. So it was totally meant in jest. And it was really fun. And, you know, as a fan, I was like, hell yeah, that's the coolest thing ever, right? And then I wanted to put it in my Wikipedia page, like the R2-D2 incident, you know. But we lost Kenny, you know, recently. And I had a lot of. I got to record. I had a recording.
We lost
of
Kenny
him.
And Carrie.
Yeah, we did. And I had some really. I saw Kenny on several occasions, and what a fun guy to be around. Also, I'm a huge fan of his in Time Bandits. I'm a huge fan of his in a lot of other work. So it was really thrilling to, you know, I've had the privilege of just being, you know, the lowest level in the totem pole in the green room, meet all my heroes. So I met Adam West before he died. I got to tell Adam West my favorite Batman line.
Was that at MegaCon Orlando?
That was at MegaCon Toronto.
Oh, Toronto.
I met him.
Okay.
And I asked his handler if I could chat with him in the green room, because you always want to be respectful like that. I never, ever just want to, you know, jokingly bust into a, you know, some conversation or start talking to somebody who doesn't, you know, want to be talked to. So usually if I'm in the green room, I'll ask their handlers if it's okay if I, you know, chat, because they get inundated with this stuff. And, you know, they're it's not a big, you know, prima donna thing as much as it is everybody's up these guys' asses for like 30 or 40 years. So they get sick of every, you know, when they go to the green room, they don't want to be bothered by another fan, even that fan happens to be an actor on another show, which would be me. So I got permission to talk to Adam, and I was a huge Adam West Batman fan when I was a kid. And I said, hey, can I tell you my favorite line from the Batman series? And he's like, no problem. And I said, here it is. Quick, Robin, get the bat alphabet soup container. And he could not stop laughing. That's an actual line from the show where they found a riddle in the Riddler. I think this is true. This is how I remember. They found a riddle from the Riddler written in alphabet soup. And Batman says, get the bat alphabet soup container. I'm like,
I remember
they
that.
Have a contingency plan for alphabet yeah. soup. Like,
that show was wacky.
Oh, he was such a prince about it, and, you know, such an amazing guy about it. I had the privilege of being able to express my love and gratitude to guys who influenced me. And I never got to meet Robin Williams, who was a huge influence on me. So
you got to meet Rob Paulsen.
Rob Paulsen's a massive influence on me. I have hung out with Rob Paulsen. I consider Rob Paulsen a friend.
Yeah.
Rob Paulsen and I talk about cars and stuff every time I see him at a show. He's probably the nicest guy I've ever met in my life, I have to say. And I'm sorry if that offends anybody who is also a nice guy in my life. But
you voice Raphael in Turtles Forever?
I voiced Mirage Raphael in Turtles Forever, yeah. The 1983 one,
I had to talk like this or something. I can't remember what it was, but it was...
So you have that in common with him, like, you know,
Raphael. We have that in common. And I also... Dude, I came home from college every day, and I was watching Pinky and the Brain and Animaniacs in college. Like, I was there, you know, I was still a kid in college, so I was like, I was watching their shit all the time and trying to do those voices. I could not, I still can't do a Brain voice, and I see Maurice all the time. I bumped into Maurice in L.A., and that guy is also
LaMarche.
Amazing, who's also a classical music aficionado.
LaMarche?
We talk about classical, yeah, he's into classical music. So these guys, it's just been a dream for me. And just, here's the deal. At the end of the day, despite anything I bitch about, or what I'm worried about, at the end of the day, the bulk of the pie, after all the trials and tribulations, has been absolutely the greatest thing in the whole world.
Part two, we're going to go into the real controversial stuff. We're going to address Goku Black as well. Whole bunch of stuff that people have been wondering about. I have so many more questions for you. Like, I have other questions about, like, Fallout, but... We're out of time.
We have been talking longer than I expected. I know it's a long interview, and if you've got to break this one up, that's fine. Maybe do a three-parter. But, I think we covered the questions you wanted to ask, I guess.
Well, I had more, but I can always fill them in next time. Not a big deal.
Are they professional-related or personal?
Well, I was going to ask you about Fallout. Like, if you were a fan of the game and your voice talent on there and things like that.
Oh, yeah, I totally was. Yeah, we should save that for the next time. But, yeah, totally. I love working on Fallout. It was great. I finished the game. I love the game.
Yeah, I want to talk to you about that next time. But we are going to address some of the hard issues in the next interview. But it was great talking to you and getting to know you. Like, you know, the past, how you got into voice, how you got into music. Because, you know, you're just an artist one way or another. You know, like it or not, that's what you are. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Music, voice.
I mean, look. Look, I'm a huge fan of many different bands. And every once in a while, they put out an album that sucks. But I don't, you know, call them up and tell them it sucks because they're not going to listen to me. And B, I don't stop liking them because that one album sucks. And sometimes if I listen to the album enough, I actually start liking it. So, you know, it's...
Right.
I guess I'm just, you know, I've been in this position and maybe I'm sensitive to it for a number of years. And I guess my message here, love me or hate me, can I have a little respect? I'm trying to respect you by listening to you hate me. So... You know, and don't get me wrong, I am constantly, you know, arguing and fighting and trying to do this character, the service, the best way I know how under very trying and very difficult circumstances for over 20 years for very, very, very little pay. So, and that's not a diss at my employers. That's just the reality of the situation.
That's the business.
So, you know, I enjoy the interview and I like talking with you, and we're going to talk about the controversial stuff next time. I'm irritated that I have to even address it. Why should I even have to do that? Come on. You know, that's just, to me, it's just a bunch of verbal masturbation, and it's just,
I do want to talk about some fun stuff too next time. I have some fun questions that I'm not going to spoil that I think we'll have a good time with.
No, yeah, we're going to do some fun stuff too, but, you know, I love all my fans, even the ones that are hating on me. And man, it's, look, even if someone's hating on you, they're paying you attention and they're saying they really love the show. And that's, an actor couldn't ask for anything better. I mean, look, if I were to go on in my career and do some really crazy famous shit and be some kind of A-list actor, Dragon Ball would still probably be the most awesome thing I'd ever done because of the specialness of the fans and the experience I've and the property, especially the story and what it means to me metaphorically. Like, I was born in the year of the monkey. You know, my grandmother used to refer to the dimples on my spine when I'd take a shower as where they ripped off my tail. Like that.
Really?
Oh yeah, that totally happened.
It's almost like you were born, like destined in a way,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Weird.
And that's weird. How, you know, that's how my nickname as a kid was Monkey Boy. Like,
that's,
I was always
crazy.
Monkeying around. Oh yeah, all that stuff's true. So I look at it as my attitude toward Goku is that, you know, I used to say this before
destiny.
Dragon Ball Super came out. My attitude toward Goku has always been, this is what I was put on Earth to do. Once I finish doing it, it's okay if I die, get killed, or whatever. As long as I finish my mission on Earth, you know, then I can be done. And then I thought I was going to be done, you know, after Dragon Ball Z Kai, and then we did a movie. Then we did another movie. Then I thought I was done. Then we did Super. And then I think I'm done. Now there's another movie. Then I'm thinking, then there's rumors of another series, which I can't confirm or deny because I honestly don't know anything. So, you know, my life, whether I like it or not, is playing Goku. Luckily, I like it.
Right.
But, you know, when I look at all the other variables, you know, there's a reason I have a Monkey King statue on my desk next to a statue of Bodhidharma, who took Buddhism to China. There's a reason I have those things there, because they remind me of, you know, who I was before I was a character. And to me, when I play Goku, it does not feel like an accident. On the one hand, I'm surprised I have the part. On the other hand, it feels as natural as being Sean and natural as being me. So, as long as fans love me and Funimation loves me, I'm here to stay. Otherwise, somebody will fire me or something. But
that would piss a lot of people off, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, and I appreciate the support when people say, keep doing it. I mean, that's the reason I keep doing it. I mean, it's challenging to play a character like this for 20 years. You know, actors leave roles for less than that. So it happens all the time. It's definitely something that, means a lot to me. Why is this smell in here? Hang on a second. My bathroom smells funny. I don't know. Sorry, I'm digressing. It smelled like bleach or something. I don't know. I digress. Anyway, I will let you go.
Yes. Well, thank you for being here, Sean. It means a lot to me. And this was a good appetizer. Next time we have the whole enchilada, the main course. So thanks so much for being here, and we'll catch you in the next one. Part 2 coming very soon.
Yeah, well, I'm excited because, you know, we're about to do San Diego Comic-Con, and we're going to do some big announcements there. I'm real excited about that. We already had a big announcement today with the release of the movie featuring Broly. We're going to talk about that next time. And so I think I'll have some fun things to report and talk about after San Diego Comic-Con. So it should be a pretty wild ride.
Okay. Well, thanks, and I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you, Mr. Dumb. I mean, Mr. Geek. Mr. Geekdom. Thank you, Geekdom. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Bye.
Later.